From the Seat Story Cup 4 studio here in Krefeld, Germany, I'm Frode, and I'm joined by Lothar and Nox once again. We're going to go for our second match in Group B, and we didn't do a good job at all in the intro, so we're going to go ahead and show you guys the graphic now for what the brackets are. I'll take responsibility.
This sure.
Cool. I just kind of came in, bombarded, didn't really do anything. So on my screen here is, if you go to taketv.net, you can see the brackets for Seat Story Cup 4. We're doing 32-man double group eliminations. And we have four groups that are going to be playing today, these four. And then groups E to H will be played tomorrow. And then day three will be the round of 16, another four groups. And then the last day will be the playoffs. As you can see, we're going through group B. RDU just beat ECOP, and then Elliot will play Vortex. The winner of each of those matches will play each other for a chance to move to the round of 16. And then group A happening, I believe, on the B stream is Firebat Purple, Cypher, and Martin Creek from SK Gaming. Mm-hmm. You might have not heard of a couple of these players, but they are all pretty good players that you have to be careful of.
Cypher is currently in Fate to Karma, yep. And he's always under the radar.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, he got second. I know he got second place in what was it? The Vulcan League a while back. Trump
right.
got first place.
Yeah, he lost to Trump in the finals. So he's definitely a player to look out for. Group C, which might be on stream. I think we have to determine which one will be on the main stream, which one will be on the second stream, which is over at twitch.tv/taketv. Group C is Zalay, 6-0, Gaara, and Alesh. And then Group D is Orange, Stan Sivka, who I'm excited to see.
Yeah,
Toyota and Surrender from Korea.
I mean, Group D is just a killer group.
Yeah, I feel like that's kind of the stacked group, but at the same time, Toyota is kind of like one of the creative deck builders out there.
I think Group C is also really tough. Zalay, 6-0, Gaara, and Alesh, all of them be argued to be the, like aces or close to the ace of their team. Like, Zalay performed very well for Archon this year, 6-0.
Yeah.
I mean, I guess you can say Osaka has better results recently, considering, but 6-0 has always been performing the most, the best out of all of Na'Vi players. And then Gaara is pretty much Devil's only hope to win a tournament ever.
That's right, he's like, I want to go through these, right?
And then Alesh is MYA's ace.
So. Reyna won Lord of the Arena first.
Yeah, that's right. But I was talking about irrelevant tournaments this year.
Sorry.
So,
hope
you guys are enjoying so far. This is, again, Seat Story Cup. Make sure you guys hashtag SSC4 on social media and let everyone know that it's going on. Eloise versus Vortex, that brings us to our match, which I think is about to begin. I think this one is cool because this is one of the first tournaments that we'll be able to see Eloise playing offline on the Western event. She's actually played a lot of offline events in China, but she hasn't had too many chances to play in a real tournament in the West yet. In fact, she's never been to Europe prior to coming here.
Yeah. Oh, really?
Really?
Interesting.
Yeah, it was the first, because it's really hard. You have to get like a visa process with a bunch of approvals from China, and it was like a really complicated thing. Yeah. So
going out of China was kind of difficult.
Yeah,
in the first place,
she was supposed to go to DreamHack Summer, but the visa got denied. Actually,
right.
They just said you couldn't go, and then everyone kind of theorized like, hey, "Is it Magic Amy 2.0?"
But it was right.
Which it totally is. Yeah. Yeah, you should ask her herself.
Picked up another Asian girl.
Which has, she actually has like a very eerily similar name to Magic Amy too, which is really funny.
Yeah.
Because Magic Amy's real name is like Hyrin, and then her real name is Hyrin, which is just, sounds exactly the same. So. Yeah, I mean, there's some weird skamasting going on here, man. I don't even know.
Wow, you get the job second time.
You get the job. You're like, please hire me back, boss.
You got me, dude.
All right, well, we're going to go into game number one. Remember, this is last year standing. They will ban a class from each other, and I believe Eloise told me that she wants to ban Paladin, if Vortex even has it.
Interesting.
Do we have two classes?
I know this because we were talking about strategy with Gaara earlier. From the Temple Storm side stuff. So, do we have the classes? I don't know.
I mean, we'll see it in a second.
Yeah, and it looks like Eloise has Warrior with Shredder and Whirlwind, so that implies that it's Patron. And then the Druid has Ragnaros in it, which is interesting.
It's I kind of like again. It. It's one of those cards where, you know, people play BGH for Dr. Boom, but Rag will stick a lot nowadays because the double BGH with no hand locks just doesn't happen as much.
Yeah, I wonder how much it is tech against Freeze Mage these days, because it's like Druid versus Freeze Mage used to be much stronger before Emperor Thorazin came out, and then Emperor Thorazin like actually improved his win rate a lot. Mm-hmm. And then now it's like, even though Druid definitely is still very much favored, it's not nearly as dominant as it once was.
Yeah, but Ragnaros is just win condition.
Yeah,
itself.
It's just so sick.
Yeah, and the Aspiring doesn't really help you in that matchup as much as you might like.
Well, you know, the ramps.
In other matchups, it will do a lot.
I really love how Eloise was tremulously promoting Tempo Storm instead of her head, but it moved the camera.
Yeah, that's right. We don't want to see that. Yeah. Well, you know, Eloise, she really likes this Patron deck. She told me that she practiced it a ton, and then they nerfed it, and she was pretty sad. She was one of those people that, like, didn't play Patron when it was popular, and then, like, towards the end, but right before it got nerfed, she was, like, practicing a ton, and then got nerfed, and she's like, I don't
know. She stuck to it anyway, right?
And so now it's like, Sixos and Oskaka have proven to be very successful, and she's like, yeah, maybe I should play it again.
It's not exactly a very fast start for the Druid player, but
no,
I mean the double
Shredder,
yeah, it's like it's absolutely awful. It's gonna let the Warrior develop a weapon, which is probably obviously one of the things that you're the most scared about.
Oh wow,
that's great draw.
Wow, it's
Eloise has a really great opener against any kind of Druid because 10/5 Patron with a Inner Rage into let's say Golem 10/4 is just insane. Because how it is with Druid, we always have problems with bodies on board. So you just need to deal damage to those minions, otherwise you have no removal. So swipe is basically useless in most situations.
The Patient Flood is still really powerful against what Druid does because their best removal options are still swipe. It hasn't changed at all.
Yeah, I don't think it will change either for a while unless they get another AoE.
I don't think they
have room for that.
Yeah, I'm not thinking anything in League of Explorers to really change that. They got the Raptor, they got the...
The one mana Raven Idol. There's another fun card that's for Beast as well. The Moonkin guy.
You're right, Lothar.
I mean, it's really loud in my headphones.
Oh, gotcha.
Can't really do nothing about it.
Lothar just loves being soft about stuff. So
It makes me uncomfortable.
Soft talk and soft listening.
I was told yesterday. Over the last 2 days, that every single Hearthstone player ever is a diva.
I'm a diva, man. That's why I got a diva tattoo.
Too. Yeah.
Oh, there's actually a running joke within production that Frodan's a diva, so...
It's not a joke, man.
That's right, man.
It's only a joke. It's Frodan. I'm
really demanding.
He's like, oh, you guys are funny. No, that's
cool.
Not a joke. You see, this is hilarious.
Vortex is in a very undesirable position of like, well, my opponent drew cards. I also had a bad drop off of Shredder. I didn't silence the target. I'm going to play Drew the Claw to challenge the board, except... Now Eloise gets time to really set up for things like the Dr. Boom following turns, so she's got lots of things to do here.
I mean, one of the things that you might have been worried about if you were Vortex here was playing the Druid of the Claw, instead of going for Keeper of the Grove last turn, he played Shredder, instead of playing Keeper of the Grove, because playing Shredder... Sure, the Cruel Taskmaster might happen, the Inner Rage might happen, but they're going to want to keep that for a bit later.
Eloise doesn't want to overdraw, obviously, I think. She had the opportunity of Cruel Taskmaster to do it, but then I think she doesn't want to just draw too many cards and maybe even develop like something beforehand so that she can get a clean Dr. Boom next turn.
Yeah, the Ghoul looks pretty good anyway, right? You could play the Ghoul here, you execute, and you're setting up a decent Patron turn. On turn
six. I mean, this gives options. You can choose to develop Patron, or you can set up Dr. Boom. Like this gives a lot of options against Druid, which on turn six is usually limited.
Oh, you saw an execute.
Right.
Now you've got to be worried about the Whirlwind effect.
I mean, I would still go for the Ragnaros here, I guess.
Think so.
I mean, I don't hate the Keeper of the Grove on the Ghoul with Innervate Shredder, but there is a Fiery War Axe already, you know, on the board, so.
Which is funny because that's a, you know, playing the Ragnaros is just feeding directly into the big game.
Right, runner, the BGH.
And then setting up really bad tempo. So in some ways, this is a very good move for Vortex as opposed to just all-inning on the Innervate Ragnaros.
Play it slowly. I mean, you can curve into Ancient of Lore afterwards and then Rag naturally. And on turn 7, you can also go for a Dredrake Wrath. So yep, you have more options by going for the double 4 drop.
Lotheb.
Huh.
I don't think we see... Do we see Lotheb? We do.
It is kind of common nowadays. Yeah. But it took a while before it got to that point. Well, a while. Like a week and a half. I think...
Yeah, I remember 6-0 running Lotheb, which was like pretty powerful. So.
And before Fellreavers also making its way into... Patient.
So, is it the turn to develop Dr. Boom? Because you have the coin, and you have the weapon to help control like the board a little bit with whatever comes out Shredder.
Yeah, I mean, there's also the option of Patron into Krolt Task Inner Rage, where you don't get the Whirlwind effect, of course, but you do get two of your patrons are going to be on 2 health.
But I think if you draw Whirlwind anytime, you get kind of the same impact.
If not, yeah, you're right.
Right. And then... You know, in some ways, having the cool Taskmaster even still continues to open up options. Now, all of a sudden, you can BGH other targets. You can use Inner Rage on your own stuff. Like, you just give flexibility with things.
Oh, my God.
Big draw. Big time draw here for Vortex. Because prior to that, he was going to be in danger of just getting overpowered here. He would have to, like, Drake and Wrath.
And Wrath, yeah, that was going to be, like, trade the Shredder away and then...
The first reaction here, what would you like to do is to kill the Amos move with the Paladin Shredder and then Big Game Hunter, right?
Yeah.
Well,
and
maybe...
Hero Power, one of the bombs.
Right. Before the BGH.
But isn't that the best play this turn?
I feel like that's what it is, like instinctively. Would you cycle your Wrath, maybe? Like, kill the other Boombot? That's another question. I'm not sure it's necessarily good. Mm-hmm. But you have the mana for it, and you can curve into Rag. So the more you clean up the board for that Ragnaros hit, the better off it'll be.
No, this was just so big on a lot of levels. Like, as long as it doesn't kill, like, the Shredder or, like, Revenge kill stuff. In fact, he's saving his Wrath so that he keeps his options. Right.
Patrons are always an issue, so. Uh-oh.
Oh, my
goodness.
There we go.
He called it, Froden.
Yeah, that's a lot of... Oh, wait, he's still, she is still one mana off from being able to go, like, completely off.
Right.
It's magic game.
Because you
want to
be able
bad.
To cool Taskmaster. What's up?
It's magic game. You don't feel bad.
Still too soon. Still too soon. The cool Taskmaster ideally would like to come off with the patron. But, you know, this does give opportunity for her to be flexible.
Well, now that looks like a patron turn because your Whirlwind is amazing in this spot. So even though you might want to wait because the two minions are one health, you could play the Axe and play it a bit slower, like you mentioned.
I mean, there's also the possibility of whatever comes out of Shredder is disastrous.
Doomsayer.
Doomsayer is bad. Anything with 3 attack higher is bad. Oh, that's so bad for the Druid. What are you doing the 1 for? Kill off the 5-1, I guess? Yeah, I guess.
I mean, you can trade it away somebody easily, so it's not that big of a deal, but it is
you
really...
You wanted a 3 attack
minion.
Exactly.
You wanted to kill at least even 2. Right?
Yeah.
Just to kill the 3-2 and then use the double Wrath on the 3 health minions, but now...
Why not Ragnaros?
So trade the 1-4 and then Ragnaros uh-huh. and force force him to have BGH or an Execute
Ooh,
number 2,
him?
Which you've already seen.
That's true. He already used 1 Execute.
You did see 1 Execute, so...
But if he lands on 1 patron, you give him the opportunity to develop more, or give her the opportunity to develop more. Bad habits, man. My casting mechanics...
Your esports are going to have to evolve with the times, right?
That's
exactly
right.
What's going to happen. It was largely dominated by very manly males.
Manly males?
Yeah, that's
wow.
right.
Yeah.
There's going to be people obviously outraging. It's like, I majored in women's studies in college and you're triggering me. It's like,
who do you not trigger at any point anyway nowadays?
Yeah, that's true.
Take a breath.
He Wrath twice here, and he ends up giving up 4 mana, which feels like he's really hoping that Patron can't get copied again.
Yeah. This is why I like the Ragnaros more in theory, because you did so, as I said, one to execute,
right.
And you use your mana more efficiently. Mm-hmm. So if you basically do the same. If your opponent has a way to refill the board, he will do it anyway. Mm-hmm. And you will lose your whole turn with Ragnaros next turn. either way, right?
Yeah.
So why not go aggressively, play Ragnaros, be efficient, and have an opportunity to clear two patrons next turn and the third patron with your Ragnaros, if it lives, of course, because you have no idea if there will be the second Execute or Big Game Hunter.
Sure, that makes sense. I also do like this play from Eloise because she's anticipating that the best way to deal with this is swipe, and that will cost the entire turn and give a free development for Sylvanas on the following turn.
Yeah, Sylvanas as well, which is kind of an interesting inclusion in Patron because you do see it. A lot of people have been cutting Emperor completely out of the list because it's not as combo-centric, so we really don't need the mana reduction as much. And so Sylvanas is a good substitute. Some people are also looking at Paladin Sky Golem as a tempo tool in that deck. It's not going to replace Sylvanas, but you could put it on, curve up a little bit.
Maybe.
I kind of like the tempo approach. It's fun to see that, Warrior finally has a tempo deck that's got combo options in it.
Yeah, and a lot of people have said, it's basically Control Warrior, yeah. and then every unviable version of Warrior, like Mech Warrior or Warrior.
Yeah, exactly.
Which Raynad has tried to make many times and failed. So, there's a lot of arguments for and against. It's very interesting. And that Dread Corsair is also a pretty cool pickup because that is 9 mana perfectly with the Fiery War Axe, the Dread Corsair, and the Sylvanas. And Druid, unless he's running Mind Control tech, is just going to kind of get overwhelmed. And even then, there's 3 minions on board that, all are big threats.
So, would a swipe help you out? Because that's the question at this point.
Not really.
Yeah, not if this play lines up this way with a trade.
Yeah, how do you deal with a board like this that continues to expand as you destroy it? And it's you need Mind Control tech. That's the only way you can handle it. And if you play Ragnaros, he just steals it with Sylvanas.
Deathwing! No. Oh.
That's it.
No, Deathwing gets stolen.
Yeah.
Good play.
No, there's absolutely nothing here that works.
Yeah. I'm actually kind of baffled by how one-sided this game was based off the way the early game draws was, but you just see how Druid, without that Wild Growth, without those Darnassus Aspirants,
with
just pitifully weak.
Yep, that's why you ban Druid.
That's why you ban Druid. Oh!
Shots fired! E-cop again!
He's not even here.
I mean, Druid has been doing it very well in tournaments, though, recently, so there's probably a fear that it will continue to be good.
This doesn't happen every time. Seriously, people will ban Druid in this tournament, because many of the players I hear here are actually talking about banning Druid.
Yeah,
unless this is some mind games. Yeah,
I mean, one person actually did do it.
He was, part of the conversation. He was maybe I do it too.
Maybe he started.
Maybe he got overheard the conversation.
It was a trap set up by RDU.
Yeah, he was like, oh, I didn't really practice much for tournaments. But maybe he heard some people's strategy through that. He's like, I actually did. I don't know. But now that Druid has Wild Growth and Darnassus Aspirin, I think there's something absurd, a 70% chance to draw it in the opening hand. Purple knows the man. It's purple.
The mess. 70%. If you hard mull again, it's actually 70-ish.
Okay, yeah.
For the four of them.
Yeah, and then you can also draw it on turn two, too.
So there's the Innervate that helps as well to ramp up. So,
Druid doesn't have that every game. It's a little bit unfortunate for Vortex. But now there's Druid's eliminated. So if Eloise, I don't know if she's bringing Mage at all, but if she had Freeze Mage and, say she banned Warrior, for example, then that'd be, a really powerful thing, but...
Yeah, we haven't seen the lineups, I don't think.
I think we did, I just didn't pay attention to the overlay. That's a little bit my bad.
Oh, yeah, right.
What was the actual...
Can't remember.
Okay.
But
we saw it.
Everyone should be already aware, so we don't have to talk about it. So
I think it's fine, though, because it's C-Story Cup.
Yeah.
Ultimately... I don't know.
Yeah, Lothar's got the wandering eye, by the way. He keeps looking at chat. So
I love chat.
Yeah, if you have anything you ever want to say about Lothar, about his physical appearance or his,
I love the overlay or his subtle voice.
Go ahead.
Kiss Noxious.
He loves chat. He loves every kind of chat.
I've never heard that before. Does that just come off the top of your head?
Yeah, it's just...
That was one of my favorite memes back in the day, the cat lady.
Yeah, it was a pretty cool meme.
I don't know this one.
Basically there's a video of a woman that was submitting for OKCupid or something like that. And she created a video about herself, and she just kind of went through this thing, I like to run, and I really love cats. And then she kept talking about cats and how much she loves them. She started crying in this video. And then it just became this thing where someone remixed it into a song, and it was really, really catchy. No. Yeah.
And later that I learned, it was actually like she was an actress trying to get hired for Hollywood or something.
What? Really?
Yeah, she
Don't
said,
ruin that for me, man. You just
I got ruined for me. I have to share the ruin.
Ruined.
Ruined, yeah.
Alright, well, we can just move past that fact. Looks like we have Warrior versus Warrior.
But this time it's a Patreon with shield slams.
It's a dragon warrior.
Wait, what?
It could be a dragon warrior. It's just unstable goal to shut down paladins, maybe?
And maybe face hunters.
I mean,
it'll shut down warriors?
Yeah, that'll really help.
I mean, all those leper gnomes.
Yeah, that's true.
Although yesterday, you wouldn't believe it, but at Tespa, there was a hunter that ran, a paladin that ran double leper gnome, double heal bot. Mm-hmm.
What?
Don't ask me.
Wait, what?
Yeah, this true story.
Double leper gnome, double heal bot?
In the same deck.
They need to make a movie because the way it works, equivalent of breaking racist boundaries. It's like, but leper gnomes and heal bots never interact with each other in the same deck.
Social revolution.
It is. It is a social revolution.
Wait, I was playing Control Hunter with leper gnomes and heal bots.
Yeah, but you're not a paladin.
Did you win?
Sometimes.
That explains it.
Yep.
That is an awesome deck to think about, leper gnome. That just doesn't really make sense, but
well, I mean, it makes sense because you curve, like you start very aggressive, so you're asking questions, and then later, if you've not been able to put on the aggression, you just start playing control pally.
By the way,
that doesn't make sense.
You just we have the classes. Let's change the topic. We have the classes.
Okay, so, good.
Vortex is playing priest, druid, paladin, and warrior, and he got the priest band.
I like that a lot. It's a pretty interesting band because if you're expecting the dragon warrior against a priest, I feel like you might struggle a bit more maybe than if you're playing patron. I mean the control. Assuming this is dragon warrior.
Yeah, dragon priest seems to be something that's been really complicating a lot of decks these days because people don't really want to bring it that often, but they have to account for it in the way it handles aggressive decks.
Yeah.
So I wonder if Eloise is playing like aggro druid at all, but it's interesting. Anyways.
That's a good turn for Sylvanas, I'll say. And Vortex Band Paladin also. What does that say about his lineup? Because he has a warrior.
It means it's not patron.
He has warrior.
That's pretty much it.
Yeah, but
I think.
Warrior with unstable ghoul. Right? So this is like kind of tweaked against paladins?
Yeah, that makes sense.
I mean, we still don't know if it's dragon, so for now, like, the shield block makes me believe that it is something like a control warrior with either Nefarian or a dragon warrior
He might just play Nefarian instead of Isera.
Exactly, like, as a late game tool in control.
Which would be funny, because if you're not banning warrior, you want the mirrors, and if you want Nefarian to come out, it's like, what would you want to pull? It's very interesting you choose Nefarian over Isera, because you get the cards immediately, mm-hmm. but not only is Nefarian easier to kill, a lot of times the class cards you pull aren't like the most helpful. You have to be anticipating like what class are going to be common and then what cards you're going to pull from it. All right, well, Lotha being drawn here gives Eloise opportunities to try to deal with what happens here off the Sylvanas play. Most likely, whatever gets stolen, the Fire War Axe can deal with it.
Yeah, I mean, if the Shredder ends up giving something... Yeah. I mean, you bought the Shredder first, right? In case it's something horrible, like a Darnassus Spirit, you throw it their way.
The other option is to go for an unstable ghoul and hope that your opponent can't deal with stuff.
But right.
That's really optimistic, because if your opponent has one weapon, then Sylvanas gets a very easy trade.
Yeah, because they pop the ghoul and then she's down to 4 health. Could even manipulate it to where they kill their own Sylvanas to steal the full Shredder, but it's not worth much as a play to waste removal on this.
I mean, sometimes it is, though. The point that you want to put Shredder...
Would you like, steal a Shredder with this? Yeah.
So she ends up going for this because she doesn't want to like let Sylvanas get value. She just wants to stall for time. And then the cool thing about Unstable Ghoul is that if the minions are damaged and there's nothing else, you can Battle Rage.
Yeah.
Battle Rage gives you ability to draw cards, which is so huge. Oh, wow.
Bash does change things up, though.
Bash is like, you can part ways with that, and then you can also...
You can trade your Sylvanas.
Your Sylvanas to keep it alive.
No, Bash, Fiery War Axe, Shield Slam clears everything.
And you get the drop from the Shredder.
Yeah, exactly. Well, you don't even have to lose Sylvanas with Bash, Fiery War Axe, Shield Slam.
I think you kind
of
want...
right.
I think you... I mean, it depends on what you feel like you can get better, but Shredder is definitely one of the better drops, for sure. With the Fiery War Axe out, you're challenging up to 7 health on the next minion. And that's really good.
That's right.
For Vortex.
Wait. So
you could bash
your own Sylvanas.
Yeah, bash
right?
your own Sylvanas. Yeah.
And you just steal that Shredder.
Because the Shredder plus the Sylvanas will take whatever is coming out here.
Oh, wait, he's not doing that.
Well, he's gonna take the two drop anyway, right? And still trade.
But this two drop is much weaker.
Yeah, and this way he also uses the shield block when he has a shield slam in hand.
I
thought the bash Sylvanas was way better because you have two drops.
He wants it to deal with patrons. He's like, last game he couldn't deal with patrons fully.
That makes sense.
But he has Jesus, what's the name of the guy? Brawl. I guess maybe even two, right?
If we haven't seen it, so
can't
necessarily. Yeah,
he could also Nefarian for the brawl.
Oh my God, even two.
He could play.
I almost got that. Two
brawls
from Nefarian.
One time,
I was playing two brawls already.
One time,
that's four, though. That's a lot.
One time I got two sacrificial packs off Nefarian,
anyway.
and then I pretended like I missed Jiraxxus.
Oh my God.
So like I used it on the Infernal, and then I was like, oops, like four times, and the guy was just like, Whirlblade! And then I sacrificial packed him. So
when the rope was like already in the enemy turn.
I didn't let it rope. I just
silence, demon.
Yeah. It was highly satisfying. Well,
they're gonna keep. It feels like to be consistent, you just keep punching face here, or you don't even attack.
I mean,
was there even an attack? I didn't see an attack.
Well, from Eloise,
she attacked with
the Shredder. I mean, that's you don't.
Well, no, wait,
she had the weapon already up, right?
There was, the Shredder did not attack anything.
No, the Shredder attacked the face.
Well, no,
you can see in the match.
Oh, you're right. Never mind.
You definitely want to attack like the armor count. Like, there's no reason to leave up that much health.
No, sorry, I was under the impression that wasn't even done.
Oh, okay,
I don't know why.
No worries. So Dr. Brim being drawn here, Vortex gives him opportunity to just like make a really powerful tempo play. I think just steal the two drop is fine, and then playing Dr. Boom. You just want to control the state of the board.
I still can't understand that I'm not bashing Chaos on.
Oh, wow. Well.
It doesn't really pan out that much.
I mean,
unfortunately,
you can just leave it on board. You don't need to kill that. There's no reason to kill it.
You don't have to kill it. There's no real means with charge outside of Gromash, and that's still not even that big of a threat.
Yeah.
Not to mention that now, if you fire War Axe down Sylvanas, or she will lose the Flame Tongue Totem to the other side, giving Boom Boss more damage.
The old Flame Tongue Totem. I remember back when they used to dance all over and give lethals that way. Gaara has become a master of it.
What's funny is Eloise can like enrage her own totem, and then like use it as an activator for execute.
Oh wow!
And then
you can also use enrage on a minion to execute.
Yeah. So I'm saying, so that way she can enrage her own Flame Tongue Totem, put it to Dr. Boom, execute it, then chop down the Sylvanas and play like Lothar.
So you don't lose
it to Sylvanas. Right. Yeah, okay. Now I get you. Sorry. Yeah. I wasn't impressed on.
That would be a very costly turn, but it gives her the ability
a lot of resources.
To do it. And yeah.
But I mean, at this point, we don't
She's
have
really
patron. Like exactly, we don't have patrons. Like your game plan is.
Oh. Oh. Okay. So she wants to play Sylvanas back, and then let maybe the good trades and whatnot allow her to steal something back.
Uh-huh.
That's fine too. So like you know, not executing Dr. Boom because. She realizes that Sylvanas would have value.
Yeah. So I guess you can just play Nefarian and just go face.
This could backfire if there's even just a whirlwind, because then you know the Flame Tongue gets killed, the Boombots die, Sylvanas steals a big minion, and the other one gets executed. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Maybe just unstable ghouls to do it right back, but then the Boombots die, so mm-hmm. that's a big risk. And you know that Eloise has a weapon. So it's not like unstable has value.
Right.
You could armor smith and just kind of gamble.
You could also attack the Sylvanas with Dr. Boom, and if it gets picked up, then you can counter it immediately. And if it doesn't, then you're fine.
Okay, that's not bad.
Yeah.
The sound come.
I was going to say, what are the odds that Dr. Boom's dead after this Boombot trade?
One out of eight. Or actually, one out of eight.
Wow, the best of every world, basically.
Is it?
Well, it hit the Flame Tongue, it didn't die.
Well, I guess you would rather see Boombot being killed because your Flame Tongue
Totem
is not
Oh my goodness, what a draw!
Look at that.
Big game hunter.
With DX, I mean, I don't know if that really brings Eloise back in the game, but because there's no more threats from Vortex, I feel like that could be it.
By the way, we didn't talk about the Nefarian draws.
Mortal Strike and Rampage.
Those are very, very, very good.
I mean, Rampage that's on a Flame Tongue Totem becomes a 3-4 that buffs adjacent minions by 2 attack.
Would you play that?
Wow. That's like a good card, almost.
I would actually play a 4-drop that gave plus 2 attack to adjacent minions in Warrior. A 4-mana 3-4, it looks like that's what they're doing too. They're pushing some of those in the
what, 4-mana 3-4s?
Like the mech guy, and they're pushing the paladin card.
Which mech guy?
The gorilla bot A3? I'm not sure, the one that draws mechs. 4-mana 3-4 with an ability. Voidcaller is also one of those cards. I feel like they're going for 4-mana 3-4s a bit more going forward with nice abilities.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I have to actually look at the cards. I'm not familiar with all the names.
The guy that draws mechs.
I didn't do like a card review.
To show how little
I understand about Hearthstone.
That's fine.
I actually don't know. I would call every card incorrectly if I knew one of those. So that was a pretty powerful turn by Eloise to just dump her hand, but this is all she has. And with Patron, you need to be able to like curve out pretty decently. That's the very powerful thing about it.
But there's no real follow-up either from Vortex. So, you know, if Grom or Dr. Boom gets picked up from Eloise.
That's true. The board could swing. But, he does have the Rampage. And that Rampage...
Oh, no. Damn. Please, Prodan.
Dude, have you seen buffed Armorsmiths like Hobgoblin? Those things are intense.
Fierce. It's actually really scary.
You buff an Armorsmith, that may be the last thing you ever do in Hearthstone.
Do you believe I have to wonder if one day we won't have like a Warrior Hobgoblin deck.
Oh, 4 damage.
Almost there, but that double shreds with the Armorsmith.
Wow.
The Whirlwind is perfect right now.
Yeah, you can kill your own minions. If
your co-op Tavern Brawl objective is to kill one of yourself, then you should Whirlwind here. Other than that, there's really nothing else. So, I mean, she can think over her plays, but maybe think about that Boombot and that 4 damage and how much you just hate Boombots.
But in general, this matchup is not that great for Patriots.
No, it's actually pretty terrible.
If you lose this match, it doesn't feel like, oh god, I just lost the match because it's last hero standing and I just lost the favorite matchup for this class.
Right, because I mean, if you look at something like... Patriots is a tempo deck, but the thing is that the Patriots' value in this matchup is almost null because of the amount of removal Warriors have. You know, if you try to pull off a tempo play as Druid against Warrior, it works because they don't have good answers. But Patriots kind of a one-trick pony.
It feels like there is an edge for Eloise, because if you kind of look at the way the rest of the series pans out, then she can play whatever druid she has into the warrior.
Yeah.
And then you use the paladin to kill the druid, and then maybe you have hunter against that.
Well, he plays this really greedy warrior.
Super greedy.
Isera and Nefari.
What if there's actually 2 Alex Strahdos champions and we just haven't seen them?
That's kind of excessive. Now he will draw those 2 mana, 2
full
minions.
Wow, that's perfect. Grom, Whirlwind, Execute, go face.
Yeah. And then reduce the shield so that Shield Slam can't be relevant. I mean, this is Eloise's only chance to stay in the game here.
Wait. Bash, 3 damage, armor up 5.
Yeah, Mortal Strike works as well.
Oh, that's true.
Even he has the attack, right? He can take the 10 damage. That's not a big deal when the Patron Warrior has 1 cut and has no charge minions whatsoever.
But it could be Deathwing. Oh, no.
Deathwing would be surprising, for sure. It's got that synergy with the Patron Flood.
Yeah.
By this logic, you can also play Baron Geddon in your Patron Warrior.
If you're a real man, you hit Grom with the face and you Mortal Strike it down and save the bash. I say real man.
I actually like that play a lot. It's kind of cool.
I mean, you can just...
You attack,
you rampage
and then
first,
you bash
you
and slam. Because you have Mortal Strike and save it for next turn.
You bash the Grom and then you Baron get it. How about that? So then you hurt yourself, but you're not afraid of damage.
And then all of a sudden, the game is lost and nobody knows why.
Yeah.
Oh, look at that!
Oh, he takes the damage!
He's doing it!
Wait, but he did it without getting armor at the last second.
That's okay.
No, it's not.
He missed one armor.
So, and that can change a lot.
But he goes within the range of Mortal Strike.
He would still have it, because it's...
Right,
there's
right.
no difference.
And now he's not able to kill a patron.
Oh my goodness, wait, and he's also gonna do damage to himself.
But it doesn't have lethal?
No. Oh, does he have lethal?
Well, no, the ghoul might help, but Rampage, wait. If you shield slam your get it up to 10, Mortal Strike.
Wait, you can armor up,
shield slam your own Baron Geddon, and then Rampage. Mortal Strike face and Rampage.
That's like shield slamming face equivalent. Mortal Strike is.
It's too
wait,
true.
Rampage is 3, Mortal Strike is 6.
Then 2 damage from Baron Geddon.
He would have been. Actually, yeah, he had lethal. I don't want to be that guy, but he had lethal.
Does he? That's 6 and 9.
That's 9.
How did he deal?
No, he'd be missing some.
Yeah, he's.
Oh yeah, the Geddon is act for 7. That's right. Yeah. He would be missing like right. 4 or 5. Is this really working? Eloise might be coming back into this.
I don't know because there's 2 patrons, and then you can shield slam one, and then
Mortal Strike the other, and then kill your
and
opponent.
Then she's out of cards. One thing that isn't happening is Control Warrior running away with the game with health. Oh. That's a good draw.
Yeah.
So you shield slam one. Wait.
Wait, this one.
Oh yeah, never mind. I was like, there's no lethal opportunities.
We keep calling lethals, but...
No, I just want to make sure.
Shield slam face, dude.
Shield slam face.
It's the oldest joke in the book.
Well, execute face is actually the first.
It came really close to being something.
No, the oldest one is execute Sylvanas.
that is the Dr. original Boom. Meme.
Dr. Boom.
That is.
That
dangerous. I mean, that's pretty powerful.
It's at least dangerous. Oh. Not so much anymore.
And you dream the boom.
But that's like.
That's a nightmare.
Giving him additional boom bolts.
Yeah.
That's the power of the card. But now he's just.
Now he's going to hit face. Well. Oh, unstable ghouls might weaken his cause to stay alive. Like, maybe those minions actually end up dying because of it.
Yeah, because if you go for... You know, if...
Because then you play Dr. Boom and he draws Fire Morax. Yeah. You have 4 and they just go off. Yeah. Fireworks.
That would be hilarious.
I think 5 or 6 turns have passed, by the way, and Rampage is still not played. So.
Yeah, well, are you saying it's bad?
Bad in both Arena and Constructed.
That was a good opportunity to play the Rampage.
It really was. It's a matter of perspective. He could have totally abused it.
Oh, on the Baron Geddon.
Right. Yeah. Well, yeah.
What? Yeah.
No, that wasn't even something before that.
I don't think that was a really good turn.
But then you gave up your shield slam to do it. I don't really like that, to be honest. Acolyte of Pain is not enough. She needs to snipe Lotheb.
Oh!
Well, it's... Snipe! It has a chance.
No, she just armors up.
And then Rampage.
And then the
Rampage!
Rampage!
Although, and you just said Vortex could just draw damage. Constructed.
Or that.
Oh, man.
Very, very, very defensive warrior.
Bam, for 8 with Lotheb.
There it is.
It's almost like a villain's chosen.
Right, okay,
the boom bots for Eloise have not been that great. Her Dr. Boom on the previous game also did like 1 damage.
And she took 4 on Lotheb.
Right,
out of the
so, I mean, I don't think that Lotheb damage ultimately truly mattered because he had Fiery War Axe up, but it definitely was
if the boom bots would hit differently, Vortex wouldn't have traded with his weapon to the Grommash.
The Grommash
so
would
be like on, you know, 20 HP or something. So
he wouldn't position himself to be
exactly
killed.
In this situation.
Yeah. Well, here we go. Druid looks like to be a standard Druid. Wild Growth and the Darnassus Aspirant, both powerful cards early ramp, and no Fiery War Axe for the Warrior. Warrior has been able to deal with Druid's shenanigans much easier these days because of Bash. We're back on camera.
I don't know why. I guess they just want to troll
you. Noxious is in a state of Zen. Actually, you can't even really see it, but he's folded his legs Lotus style. Like he's some monk. And he's got his chest puffed
like he's dung.
So, no, I'm just like laying back.
Yeah, he's chill.
After the plane ride.
Ooh, Eloise has...
Roasting some hammer.
So this gives her the opportunity to Wild Growth Darnassus Aspirant and then go... Or sorry, Coin Darnassus Aspirant to Wild Growth and Druid the Claw instead of her 5 drop.
The thing is, like, is there any... the advantage of coining out the Aspirant is only because you'll be able to scout for War Axe right now. But if you play the Wild Growth and you top deck the Shade, you could technically play it immediately. Whereas if you play the Aspirant and the Axe comes out, then the Shade is no longer playable.
How about just Wild Growth the following turn?
Yeah, but that slows the Shade down. But it's just one turn. I don't know if it matters that much. It's a very...
But then you get... by coining out the Darnassus Aspirant, you get more damage out immediately and more pressure.
Right. So like, if it doesn't get answered, then you're racing ahead really quickly.
I like the coming out of the restaurant.
Yeah.
Oh, it's always better when you have the Wild Grover in hand. You lose 10.
That aspirant, though, just like not being answered is a really big deal. You get to play Armorsmith. If you don't play Armorsmith, you're not dealing with the aspirant the following turn.
Yeah,
I guess two turns of Wild Growth, and that's equivalent of like Innervate on attached to these Darnassus aspirant, which also soaks up removal with like Bash.
That's a really good metaphor.
Which what?
I mean, the
comparison, I guess.
Yeah, comparisons.
Now,
she will Wild Growth. I think the interesting thing is what she chooses to attack here. If you choose to attack the Armorsmith, you're playing directly on Cruel Taskmaster.
I don't think so. You even attack the Armorsmith. Just go defense.
You also play around Bash. Like, just completely eliminating it, and then...
You
like,
can keep the Grove down... The Armorsmith afterwards. Keeper of the Grove does change that. I mean, if you had something like a Shredder, maybe your play would have been a bit different. Where you might have gone face, because Shredder would deal with the Armorsmith anyway. Yeah.
Dude, do you have to, like, execute this thing or Shield Slam?
Shield Slam is better than execute.
Yeah. Do you mean to use here or to keep?
To use here.
Yeah, because you have two executes already, so you keep your
armor. Yeah, and so. You have no means of gaining armor, apart from the single armor smith and your hero power, of course. But that's too slow for any kind of creature that the opponent has.
So. Alright, that's one execute.
She's so happy to see that. Like, execute on
a two drop. That already did what it had to, really.
It was basically the equivalent of an arcane shot. Right? It was just like, did 1 mana, 2 damage.
Yep.
Oh, right on time. Gosh.
Ruined.
Just warrior problems. I know, right? I don't even think Bob Ross could have made anything out of that situation.
Yeah, you just had to add like...
It's like that little tree that he butchers, and he's like, well, that's an ugly little tree, and then he fixes it.
Look at that. There's a tree under Vortex.
Fade to Karma.
Yeah.
That's a tree.
Fran, is that your next haircut? Like the Ross haircut? Are you trying it
out? My hair? You think my hair looks like Bob
Ross? No, but I'm asking, is that the next thing?
Oh.
You've got, like, there's a future for your hair, I'm sure. Like, you probably think about that very frequently, but...
My hair is not a happy little mistake, Nox. Jerk.
All right.
Well, this is... Awkward.
That is terrible. Wow.
What a bad spot to be put in. Although you do get to play Jestikar next turn, right?
Yeah, but that's a huge tempo loss. The fact is, like, Jestikar...
You want to play... Yeah, if you don't have something already, it's...
You're going to actually want to... Probably like bash something next turn, realistically.
And that looks like a decent turn. I mean, that's setting up an execute, though, if you think about it, because you can go bash, execute, shield slam on that turn, and probably deal with the substantial amount of cards, like of minions. You do take, you know, an upfront 5 extra damage, but I think
this is pretty big.
Yeah, it's still the best way to set up for removal that's going to be consistent.
Yeah, he can bash, like you said, armor up, shield slam. Use Fiery War Axe next turn. Give himself more options, because Jestikar is going to be just too slow. And then, like, Eloise will certainly take this opportunity to develop some tempo. Mm-hmm.
And well, that's...
something that you're looking at...
Whoa!
Holy hell.
He's playing all the legendaries that generate cards out of his deck.
Just super greed control warrior.
Yes, yes.
And you ban Paladin because you know that Paladin can out... tempo you with the 1/1s and the board flood. Mm-hmm. So you just want to win the warrior mirror. It's like good against freeze mage, it's good against like warrior mirrors and stuff.
And good against midrange paladin.
Midrange paladin, probably bad. They play it like...
I wonder like if this deck is so slow that maybe even Rogue has a chance against it if you can tempo it out.
Well, with Bash and Jestikar, it would be pretty difficult, but you can get a tempo. If there's no... We haven't seen a Brawl yet. So...
There's no way you can run like... This kind of deck.
Yeah, but is it running two? That's the question. Because usually a greedy deck like this, I would assume, would at least consider running two of them.
I guess so.
So you use Shield Slam here, right?
Probably Shield Slam because... Or you don't have an activated for execute. That makes more sense.
Boom, though.
No, you don't have armor.
You do have some armor.
Yeah, a bit.
Like, you're not getting challenged directly by it.
And then you can go Nexus Champion and armor up.
How is Vortex supposed to activate execute if Dr. Boom?
Okay, that's
so it's like the Shield Slam at least give you 3 health to attack with, or maybe 2, depending on
Twisting power. Nether. Here we go.
Twisting Nether. Here we go.
Here we go. Let's do it, boys. Nerves.
Do it.
Oh wow, that's a new meta move.
Oh my god. Not even.
Not the greatest choice from.
Yeah, choice. <Sarai.
laughs> What is that?
That was.
And ladies and gentlemen, this is why you don't run this card. Maybe in Tempo Mage, because it can, you know.
What are you talking about?
It's a card advantage, right? In Tempo Mage.
You are very optimistic. You should be the one to succeed Bob Ross.
I mean, I don't paint.
Levels. Well, it was like a Black Knight without effect.
This is just so much.
That's exactly what it was.
Eloise might be thinking about playing around in a brawl.
Yeah, you don't need to play anything with that kind of deck. Sorry, board.
But she doesn't have lethal guaranteed, I think, without it.
What do you mean? Does. Bombs do 8.
Baron Geddon actually helps kill you, even though it...
It looks like it clears the board. You're actually just dying.
No, you need a Justicar, hero power.
The Druid's going to prevail against the greedy, greedy warrior. But now the question is whether or not the Paladin is going to be able to go through the Druid and the Hunter.
Definitely through Druid. Hunter is iffy.
More difficult, yeah.
Definitely very tricky to do. Well, the tank up puts it out of range of immediate death, but the Boombots
change that. Stuff. Yeah.
You can almost guarantee...
With Keeper of the Grove, I think you could almost guarantee it.
Yeah, would you keep her like the Justicar and then... No, I think you just attack twice with Moonbots.
Into the
like,
Justicar.
Into the 6-3, right? Yeah. So then you have maximum chances. You just have to have it hit face.
That would have been better. Well, hit face, but...
Now you can argue you don't have to play minions, right? To prevent be stronger against Brawl.
There is still the Hail Mary on Shredder if the Shredder's played from Eloise. She might be considering not even doing it.
Actually, Shredder would be okay here.
Why do you risk Shredder when there can be a Doom Sword?
Yeah, exactly. Like, what if it backfires? I think that one moment in time where...
Because now, look at that. Vortex wanted to concede, and now he has the one out.
The one.
Yeah.
The only.
The one out.
And Doom Sword.
Nope, not quite.
But I mean, destroyed the weapon,
like
at least.
It's like a quote-unquote out, but, you know, on his view, he might, like, maybe she has, like... Force of Nature draw or something to just kill her.
Yeah, but he'd be dead already if that was the case. So anyway,
he had Keeper of the Grove, so if she drew Force of Nature, that's 8 damage.
Exactly,
it's enough to kill him. Yeah. So that's the game, and that's very straightforward of like Druid ramping and Warrior just not having much. But that Warrior is just so greedy.
I don't think I've ever seen
like that. Like when they wrote about like the Grinch and Scrooge McDuck, it was like based off that Warrior.
They're like, yo, Vortex, I need an idea.
Yeah, I don't know, man. It's just like Sarad.
I just feel like
Sarad does Sarah. And he still has the casual suspects like Baron Geddon, Gromash. Maybe he took out Alex Straza. Like we saw
probably
a couple
no Ragnaros.
I mean, all bets are off at this point.
I can't imagine it would find room.
Like, wait, he has Justicar too, right? And one Shoots Maiden.
Yes, and a Sylvanas.
Holy
damn. Yeah, like, I don't know
it's
how you
literally
run.
Like as if he put like a couple of Shield Slams, a Bash, and a couple of weapons with Executes, and then just did the full Golden Monkey on his deck. Like,
yeah, let's just transform into 30 legendaries. All right, so we see Quartermaster. My guess is going to be probably a mid range.
Yeah, I mean, Sludge Belcher can be in mid range in the Secret's Paladin. So can Quartermaster. I've seen some really weird decks with that. But it's generally. Like, very strong likelihood of being mid-range Paladin.
Yeah, still no secrets drawn when you've seen, you know, 7 cards out of a Paladin.
Oh, God.
Like, 9
Jesus
secrets.
Christ, you guys caught me scratching myself.
I was rubbing my
did
eyes.
Did you scratch your dragon?
No, books? It was my...
Oh, the tattoo.
Oh, yeah.
That dragon tattoo.
Area.
Out
there.
I know. Murloc Knight!
Murloc Knight... Does indicate again it's going to be mid-rangey with Paladin.
The thing is, I've seen all these cards in Secret Valley, but not all together.
Yeah, it's very unlikely with all that combination.
There's almost no way.
Even some cards like Consecration, sometimes it's cut.
Yeah.
Mid, like the mid-range Paladin versus Secret Paladin, has like strong influences on both, but it's just one of those things where you can't entirely be too sure until you see the entire 30 card list. That's what also gives that deck so much power. It's like you can't truly play around everything. Are they playing like the one true silver?
Yeah, what's their version? What's their exact version?
No true
silvers,
and you don't have to worry about it.
Pointing out a shade looks kind of fun, but that leaves you with a very bad follow-up. And at this point, Eloise has no idea what that paladin is, right? Because it could be just as typical as, yep, as far as she knows.
Yeah, Minibot so. 10-2 seems like every single paladin you can...
If it was neutral, every single person would look like a secret pally.
Yeah. Right, and this is the point where, as Druid, you'd really want Darnassus Aspirant, because... Druid can't really, or Paladin really can't answer it very easily. But
this curve is nasty, man. Turn 4, turn 5, turn 6 with a Murloc Knight. Everything is lining up.
Yeah, the curve is just too strong. But she does have the swipe.
Without the swipe, this will be already over, I would guess.
I think so, yeah.
Especially if the Shredder will be in a good spot.
She here powers Divine Shield and Telegraph Swipe. And then really scare Vortex into, like, well, what are you going to do?
Do you have Blessing of Kings? That's kind of the only thing.
Bad Shredder placement.
Shredder placement doesn't really matter if you anticipate swipe, though.
Yeah, but it might be a bluff.
Ooh, you're right.
Bluff to swipe, yeah. So if we have the... If you swipe here, you kill a Shredder, and then... If you get an Innervate, your Wrath really helps a lot.
A zero attack minion would be such a big deal for Eloise, because the zero attack minion means that the Shade won't die immediately on board. So if it's like...
Uncivil Ghoul's also quite a little... Oof. That's a bit rough.
Yeah, you kill the 2-1 because then the weapon can kill it. And then you have to trade the 3-2 or... Yeah, you basically have to trade the 3-2 into it.
Yeah, or find like a Cogham or something, but yeah. Like, there's a lot of... they're going to have to... You're playing the Shade for value at this point. There's no reason to sacrifice it for nothing.
Yep.
I mean, you force your opponent to trade the Fallen Hero into the Naxxramas, Shadow of Naxxramas, because otherwise your Battle is really bad when it dies to the Shade.
How cool would it be if, like, Fallen Hero gave your recruits +1 attack or something like that?
No, they just shoot, like, Elven Archer.
Yeah, I guess.
That'd be pretty cool. You just gotta catapult them
That would
forward.
Be wildly overpowered.
To battle! And you literally just throw them to the enemy's face.
Right. I love that it's like, well, it'd be wildly overpowered, but it makes sense in Paladin doing it. Well, Murloc Knight here summoning...
Murloc Knight, that's anything. My favorite.
So, summoning another Murloc Knight would be...
Bluegill Warrior, I bet.
No, that's not bad.
It's definitely about average, a little, slightly above average.
Well, for 6 mana, you get a 6-6.
Yeah.
But in 2 bodies, right. So it's better. And a 1-1 on the bonus, so it's basically 7-7.
I'm looking at how good a Force of Nature is in the following turn. It doesn't seem to be entirely too impressive.
It's kind of okay, though.
It kills
the
Murloc.
You really do need an Innervate, though, to use the Wrath. The extra Wrath matters a lot. Or maybe just double Wrath straight up, like somehow. I just feel like Force of Nature is too good. You have to get rid of that Knight before you're running out of life, basically.
It's definitely, the Paladin trying to out-tempo it. And then hopefully your opponent that kind of draws slightly blank, but that's not the case at all.
Oh my god.
Just a Cartoon-hearted Paladin! That is so nuts. The fact that you can summon 2 1-1s in a turn is so insanely powerful.
You don't see it very much because it seems like the mid-range lists that exist tend to err on the side of, they have a bit more of a control element to them. Like the Flood Paladin didn't stay popular for very long.
Yeah.
Like it...
I mean, the curves are just so strong. Like, you can't deal with the Paladin just flooding the board. And it's not even the Secrets Paladin. It's just Paladin with Minibot, Muster, Shredder,
When you think about it, Paladin has the best curve in the game.
Yeah, they do. It's
10-1 Zombie Trap. 10-2 Minibot. 10-3, we have... What do we have in 10-3?
Muster for battle.
Muster for battle. 10-4, we have Pilot or Shredder. 10-5, we have Belcher or Loaded. 10-6, we have Murloc Knight. Right? Turn 7, Dr. Boom. Turn 8, Tyrion.
Turn 9.
Ysera.
What's turn 9? Ysera.
Nefarian.
Turn 10, Deathwing. Turn 11.
Sea Giant.
Sea Giant is
with a mana wraith on the board.
All
right. Oh no, it discounts the 1 mana from the mana wraith by being on the board. Never mind.
Well, Eloise is pretty much out of options. I think she has to draw Swipe. Ends up just going with Shade. hero power or maybe Rask to stay alive. But she's dead to Quartermaster.
Yeah. If it is there, though, I mean, you have to.
Now Tyrion comes out. Yeah, this is just like completely domination. This is kind of like what Paladin wanted to do. And in some ways, I was expecting Druid to make it a better fight, but this was not the case at all.
I mean, you can't really challenge. If you can't challenge the mini bot early, because the way it played, you know, she used the coin on the Shade of Naxx, right? Which is exactly what we're talking about. Like, is it a good play? Because you leave yourself without a follow up. And the Shade was instrumental in deleting the 2-drop that came out of the Shredder, but it just wasn't quite enough.
Well, with the Ancient of War, Eloise does technically stay alive, but the Ironbeak Owl will not stand for that. Basically, it'll just punch through whatever comes out. The only world where Eloise was able to survive would be like to set up 2 taunts. But it's not affordable.
Yeah.
Alright, so, and you know what? There's some really good information here taken from other people, like being able to see that this is mid-range Paladin, not Secrets Paladin, probably.
Yeah, for Ardew, this will mean a lot. If Vortex.
Oh, even for Eloise.
Well, she doesn't know there's Jestigar, but she knows what type of deck it is, for sure.
She should be able to infer, it's like, well, I saw Murloc Knight, I saw Sludge Belcher. And I just saw like the regular curve, and it's like no secrets at all in a secret game is very unlikely.
Yeah. She's playing a hunter, so Unleash the Hounds can abuse that as well.
They can,
but it can be difficult depending on what archetype she's got.
Yeah. Well, she might be playing. She didn't ban Paladin; she did ban Priest, so it might be telling us that she's actually running a very aggressive hunter because it makes sense in Conquest.
Yeah, it makes sense.
It makes sense in Last Standing.
Because you can keep it as just like a way to kill someone.
Yeah, exactly.
So, if that's the case, then she would be playing a pretty aggressive hunter. Maybe it's Face Hunter. I know she was like talking about 6-0's Face Hunter back at the esports or something.
Well, there's the Leper Gnome, could be hybrid still, but that is the element that gives away the face
gnomes. And there is Lay on Hands and everything. Ooh, that's such a big deal, though.
Oh, my God.
I think Paladin may have just won.
Already?
Yeah.
I mean, he has 1, 2, 3.
I'm not saying it's over,
but it's
at all. But I'm telling you that the difference between starting with Zombie Chow and not Zombie Chow.
They're doing it every time. They're doing it every single time.
They're trolling us.
Actually, what they do is they go from Mulligan to us to game.
But did you just saw what the statue has?
The what?
Look at the statue. Look at the statue there.
Which one?
Yeah, the one in front of you.
Oh my God! Right.
Don't ask.
Well, the Glaivzuka draw was really.
That was really important for Eloise.
But not out of the woods, the pain train's gonna continue. Shielded mini bot into muster for battle.
I feel though,
and then she has a turn 4 play with shielded mini bot.
And hero power. But I feel like Eloise could still manage this, just because the Leper Gnome cures the hero power here, and you can deal with the mini bot, assuming it ends up trading. It's just that the muster for battle will deny that, assuming the paladin is willing to take some more damage.
I mean, that's kind of what you want mid-range Paladin to do. In many ways, it's pretty much a lot like Druid, where it's just like you want the curve to work out, and that's what the deck's designed to do. Sometimes it will, sometimes it won't.
Yeah, true. The only problem for Eloise here is the fact that she has a lot of damage, and the Paladin, if he doesn't run anything more than Lay on Hands in this deck...
He has to have a heal bot in this deck.
You think so?
There almost certainly is.
I mean,
you run Jestigar Trueheart. That's so bad on tempo.
No,
you know
it's,
that you're gonna need to extend the length of the game, right?
Yeah. So the thing with this type of deck is that when it's trying to be Flood Paladin, it tends to run more cards like Murloc Knight than Healbot. It's not trying to be the mid range pally. It's really like an in between between something like an aggro pally and a mid range.
So it's got something about always hitting the Divine Shield with the weapon.
I mean, she's just hoping that the Leper Gnome doesn't get traded into by Muster. And if it does, then she still thinks to herself, well, at least I'm dealing 4 damage with it, and I'm setting up an Unleash later on. And I want to play my Eaglehorn Bow on 5 after Shredder on 4.
But, I mean, the 2 damage is still a pretty big deal. Like, this game will come down to this very, very small amount of damage that you can get on both sides.
So if there won't be any kind of heal, she might be already winning.
Right.
If there would be the damage going face instead.
Mailhouse, Mana Storm. Oh.
Look at that.
That's kind
of annoying. Second time in a row.
That's really annoying.
It's just big enough that you, like, it's got more health than you can kill, but it's got too low attack for you to go and try to really kill it.
Well, Shield Mini Bot was going to be coming down anyways, but that's like a minion that complicates things for sure. Because, like, Lothep can't be played now if she draws it, or you're on both sides.
But
that Animal Companion works always because it's a spell.
If you play Leok,
you are correct.
You would kill one mini bot if you wanted.
Oh,
you have damage.
So is she playing explosive traps in that deck, or is the Mad Scientist going to get something like freezing, which is obviously a lot worse against Paladin?
It depends. I think she's also aware of, like, oh man, Consecration. Oh man. That is... Okay, wow, that's so huge.
I get the feeling that right now what she's trying to do is incentivize plays that aren't Belchers so that she can get Eagle Hornbow Hero Power in for 5.
She really cares about the Divine Shields. I think she's afraid of, like, Blessing of Kings stuff.
No, I really just feel like by doing this, she's reducing their value to where he might be willing to...
But, okay, so she's effectively missed 3 damage by doing this game so far.
Yeah.
Oh,
snake traps.
That consecration is even better now.
Yeah, now it's a much better consecration.
Dr. Boom on the follow-up, too.
And, yeah, you're right. But there is 6 damage plus kill commands. I mean, again, it's gonna come down to a race for sure.
But I think she's still in it, though, with the Eagle Horn, though.
Yeah, she needs just a little bit more.
Like, unleash the Hounds, right, off the top to go with, after the Dr. Boom comes.
Yeah, that actually could be the game-winning scenario. Yeah. The Eagle Horn bow is a big deal, too. It's like, that's 10 damage.
Oh.
He has 2 bows. That's not a really good draw, but it's still, like, something. And then now Vortex is in a situation where he's just going to coin boom, lets you draw Belcher.
And he's going to hope that there's no unleash kill command, because that would be game, right?
Even then, Belcher might be too slow. And also, does Boom even guarantee lethal next turn?
No, it doesn't yet.
So she is 3
not
damage
even
points. Chosen
the champion is not guaranteeing lethal next turn. That's a big problem. It's a really big problem. But
oh, wow.
Kill command. That's 1 damage off, I believe.
Yep.
So you play the weapon this turn. You have to play the weapon this turn.
Yeah, you have to play. You can play the weapon for sure, but then if your opponent plays Lothab, you get locked out from kill command.
Yeah, I think I do it right now because I get a kill next turn. There's no Lay on Hands coming out. But it has to be Heal Bot. It has to be True Silver Champion.
No, but then you give your opponent Boom Bot lethal.
That's right, actually.
Yeah, this is why I guess you have to play the weapon, because you have to get also mana an example for another minion of charge or another spell like Quickshot if it will be needed.
What's more likely to happen?
That she's left on 1 health? I mean, I feel like putting
God.
That could be...
I don't know about this.
I don't like this.
So
you're
playing with fire.
You start with the equality to reduce the possibility that it hits the spider again.
And now all it has to do is deal 3 damage, I think.
So 3, 7...
It has to deal 4.
And this, but
actually,
the second Boombot can do it.
You should have not play the equality.
Oh! Wait, why not?
Because then...
Oh my god. It's coming down to a 75% chance for lethal.
Because
now.
Then you would have...
You're right, you would be able to plot the spider with...
50-50, and not 33% now. Oh, no, wait, but you have... No, there's no difference.
It still goes up to...
Yeah.
I'm just jet-lagged, so...
Wait, what? Does anyone increase chances?
Oh, we got it! Oh my god! Oh, no.
That's it, by 1 damage.
Eloise is Boombot.
Yeah, the Boombots are real, and that's pretty devastating. And here you go. I mean, this is something worth talking about, but there's a lot of damage traded early on that was missed.
Right, the 2 damage from the Glaives.
Yeah. Wait. There were few occasions. 10-1 trade with Leopard Gnome.
Right.
10-4 trade with Glaivezooka to the
taking damage to yourself too.
And not dealing 2 damage to the face.
Yeah.
And then also what we had?
I don't remember any other occasion, because those are the Leopard Gnomes with the trees.
There's also the Narub Weblord.
That popped
the
shield, that's right. Mm-hmm.
There were a lot of
being 1 damage off lead. Like, we were talking about it, man. That Hunter deck definitely could have won. It probably should have won.
Should have. And it should have won if the kill command sort of would be saved next turn.
Here you go, Vortex.
Oh, that's right.
Hey, guys.
Hi, Vortex.
All right, so Vortex, you're playing really greedy warrior.
Yes.
Why?
Because I like to be greedy with the warrior. I didn't feel it's a good list, but I didn't play it correctly. I think there were some slip ups in my matches. I realized that as well. But yeah, I'll have to focus better. But I was confident with the paladin, so.
Okay.
So I have to ask you about the yes. paladin. Is it a flood paladin, or does it run like? Does it run heal bot?
He can't tell us that.
Yeah,
I don't want to go too deep in the list, but like I'm really comfortable with the list. So
Sounds good. Yeah, that's right. That's a completely terrible question.
I mean, because everyone's kind of watching the series right now, so they want to talk about it. So let's talk a little bit about what you've been up to. Can you describe like what you've been doing so far? How's your year been?
It's going okay. I was DreamHack Cluj, didn't go too well over there. And Fate to Karma, it's a really nice team. We have awesome teammates. Wire helped me a lot as well with preparing for this.
Who?
Wire, he's our analyst in our team.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
okay.
So we have...
I heard White Rod.
We have a lot of players, but we have also a lot of people that help us in the team, so... I'm really grateful for that, and it helps a lot.
All right, cool. Okay. Lothar, do you have anything?
No, I'm before you really pass tired. Out, I'm ETFO. Really tired.
All right, well, go rest, man. Go rest. All right, we'll wrap it up. I guess my last question is: do you have any final things you want to say? Like, what do you think about RDU as your next opponent here?
Well, actually, the funny thing is RDU is staying near us. Breakfast is always with RDU and stuff because we're staying at Tim's house, Teutz. And the G2 guys are also staying over there, so it will be a pretty interesting match, but I feel confident in my lineup.
All right.
So, RDU definitely feels confident in his hits.
Cool. Well, thanks so much, Vortex. Congratulations. Your job's not done. We'll see you again in the winner's match. And that means we are going to take a break and continue Group B right after this. Don't go anywhere. You're watching CSU Cup number 4.